In this video, I'm going to show you how to use Lightroom to create a panorama photo and make this final image. Hi, my name's Tim Shields. I'm a landscape photographer, and I'm going to show you how to edit a panorama image inside of Lightroom. This is an image of Spirit Island. It is located in Jasper National Park. It's a place that's very near and dear to my heart, and I'm going to show you how I created this image. I've got Adobe Lightroom open, and I've got the five images selected that we are going to make this panorama with. Before we assemble, I just want to point out the histogram, and it's very important just to note that on this particular morning, the background was very bright, the sky was bright, and you can see that none of the highlights are hitting the right-hand side, and that's because I always expose for the brights, and that means that the darks on the left-hand side of the histogram are going to be underexposed, but I can always bring those back because I'm shooting in RAW. That's really the key here. You've got to be shooting landscape photos in RAW, and if you still have your camera set to JPEG, I encourage you, set it to RAW. I've got the five photos selected underneath on the bottom row here, and I took this particular panorama from left, starting on the left side, moving to the right, and I like to do it in that order because you can see it logically across the bottom of your Lightroom screen. So the first thing I want to do is edit a photo, one of the five photos that has the brightest background, and I'm going to choose this middle one. I want to make sure I'm in the develop module of Lightroom, and I'm going to start at the very top. I'm going to warm this up a little bit just by bumping up the temperature and add a little bit of tint or magenta, but not too much. I don't want to see the magenta. I don't want it to be noticeable. So I'm going back to, I've got a 15 on the screen. That looks about right. Next, I'm just going to glance at my histogram, and I can see that there is still maybe a little bit of room on the right-hand side to brighten it up, but I'm going to drop the highlights right down to minus 100, open up the shadows to plus 100, and then look at the histogram again. And I can see that the overall shape of the histogram is a little close to the left-hand side, which means I can afford to bump it up just a touch, but it depends on what mood I'm looking for. I just want to a plus 0.19. Now let's adjust the white point. I'm holding down the Alt key and sliding slowly to the right until I start to see some pixels. So here I've gone too far because this represents blown out highlights. And I'm going to leave it about here. These are the areas of snow on the distant mountains. I'm letting go. Now let's do the same with the black point. Hold down the Alt, drag to the left. Anything that I see now will be completely black or a crushed black. And I'm going to drop it in about there. I do like to have some blacks in my photos because blacks create contrast. Now we've got the clarity and dehaze sliders. This dehaze slider, I love this thing. This is the secret to making landscape photos look fantastic, because when you increase the dehaze, it creates more contrast. See, I've got it up to 15 here. If I go a minus on the dehaze, look at that. It's just sort of a foggy effect. That's not what I want. I like contrasty, saturated photos. I'm going to leave it at 13. Now I'm going to bump up the clarity a little bit, which tends to adjust contrast in more of the highlights. Just slowly bump that up. I don't want too much because if you go too high, it gives more of an HDR look. And although I used to like that years ago, I definitely do not love it now. Next is the vibrance. Let's bump up this vibrance. I'm going to leave it at the 30. I like to see the color on this one. Saturation, I'm leaving this alone. I don't touch the saturation, but I do adjust saturation on the individual colors. So make sure that out of these three here, hue, saturation, and luminance, that saturation is highlighted. I generally go for the orange right off the top, and I'm bumping that up because that's what's going to change the color of this background, that warmth there. Bump up some yellow, and that also brings out color in the greens. And the blue is going to touch up the sky, looking nice. Let's just move up the green just a bit, see how that looks. I like it. Leave that at an 8. I'm leaving the purple, the magenta, the aqua. We do have some aquas in the water here. So let's see what happens when I bump up the aqua, move it up and then leave it. Oh, I see. It's coming up in the shade a little bit. So I'm going to just bring it back down to a 8 and let's move on. I'm leaving the split toning alone. And now let's look at the sharpening. So this is a nice sharp photo to start with. I'm going to put this up to a 75-ish. Doesn't have to be too exact. And now let's reduce some of the noise. I can see the thumbnail here, and it may be difficult for you to see it on the video, but a 13 is doing it. And now let's mask out the sky. We do not want to sharpen the sky. So I'm holding down the Alt and dragging, and anything that's black will not be sharpened. The whites will be sharpened. So I'm going to drop it right there, and that's perfect. Now I'm going to click the Remove Chromatic Aberration button. Also, the Enable Profile Corrections. This is where adjustments are made based on the camera and lens that I was using when I shot this panel. And let's scroll down. Overall, this is looking a little too blue for me. I'm going to go back to the top and warm it up just a little bit more using our temperature. There's 8,000. This is going to give the mountains more of a warm look. So overall, I'm liking what I see. So I want to apply these settings now to the other four images. And how I do that is I hold down the control button or command on a Mac and select the other four. But the photo that I actually edited is still the one that I'm seeing on the screen. And now I click on the sync button. And make sure that the settings are right. I don't want any crop to be synced. I don't want spot removal synced. That's good. So now I click synchronize. So now all of those adjustments that we just made to the one photo will be applied to all the other photos. Now I'm ready to assemble these five images into a panel. So since they're already all selected, I'm going to right click and photo merge panorama. And now we let Lightroom do its thing. And it's going to create a thumbnail image. There it is, looking nice. And there are three options that we can choose from. Generally, cylindrical gives the tallest image. So I'm going to leave it as it is now, and I'm going to click merge. And Lightroom is now going to chew on this problem. We can see the status bar in the top left of the screen. And since this is just a single row panorama, it's not going to take very long, but Lightroom works very well with single row panoramas. However, it does not work well with double row or triple row panoramas. The panorama is being created. I can see it in the bottom, and it is looking good so far. Maybe a little darker than I wanted, but let's start by cropping it, because I want the island to be exactly in the middle. I like balanced images where there's an equal amount of weight on the right and the left. And this particular composition is just made for balanced images. So I'm going to pull the right side over so that the island is right in the middle. Let's pull down some sky. Just enough. Actually, I want the island to be the hero of this story. So since it's the hero, I don't need more sky. I want this to be really the main focal point, even though in the top right, I'm about to cut off that top of the mountain there. And let's bring the bottom up. Like that. And the right-hand side, maybe just a touch, just to make sure. There it is. And now let's click the done button. It is perhaps a little too contrasty. I would like to lighten some of it up just a little bit. And to do that, I'm going to move the black point to the right, because if you look at the histogram, you can see it's bunched up over on the left-hand side. And let's just bring out some of those shadows. So I'm in a minus 29 to start with. Now let's bring it up to minus 15. And Lightroom is chewing on this task because now we have a very big image to deal with. And if I hit the I button on my keyboard, I can see that this image is 11,580 pixels wide. And that's a pretty big image. I could print this very large. So I'm happy with that. It is looking good. Maybe just a little lighter. Or we're at a minus 10. Now, if I want to enhance some of these trees here, let's use the other secret weapon with Lightroom, and that is the brush tool. And I'm just going to brush over these trees here and the bottom of the island for the purpose of bringing this part of the island a little more alive, just making it a little more of the focal point to draw the eye. Things that are bright in a photo is what first draws the eye. And what I'm battling with in this image is that the top right of the photo, the mountain that's lit by the sun, is off to one side. And although it's absolutely beautiful, I don't like the fact that this is the brightest part of the image. So I'm going to click a new brush, and I'm going to try and darken that part of the mountain just a little, just to take away a little bit of that emphasis that's on the right-hand side. Because again, the brightest parts of your image are what draws the eye. And I don't want the eye going off to the right-hand side. So I've painted the right-hand side. And now if I want to see exactly what the shape of the mask is, then if I put my mouse over this little black dot here, it's going to show up in red. And you'll notice that none of the sky was painted because we had this auto mask button selected. Going to go down to a minus 0.59. So we just took away a little bit of that bright sunshine. And if I really want to be fancy on this, let's click a new brush again. And let's try and brighten up the dark left side. I've increased the exposure to a plus 0.4. And let's just put the mouse brush over top of this dark part of the mountain and see if we can just brighten that up a bit in order to try and increase that balance of light between the left side and the right side. I'm pretty happy with that. I'm going to also hit this line of trees here because that is also very dark in the image, and especially compared with the right hand side of the image, I want to enhance some brights here. And let's also on that last one open up the shadows just a little bit, just to try and brighten that left side so that it matches the right side just a little bit. I'm going to see what it looks like as a final adjustment if I turn up the saturation on green just a touch. And in addition, I'm going to turn up the luminance on green just a little bit. See if that makes a difference in the image. And it does, especially on the middle of the island. It brightened up those greens, and that's something that I want. So there's our panorama. 11,580 pixels wide. We did that in 10 minutes. And this image is ready to be hung on the wall. The only thing I would do further would be to take a closer look at the sky when I'm zoomed in, just to make sure that there aren't any dust spots that need to be cloned out using the spot removal tool here. But that's it.
If you enjoyed this video, I'm going to ask you for a favor, and that would be to subscribe to my YouTube channel. Just click the red subscribe button. It's the same thing as following somebody on Instagram, and it helps me out. In addition, please give a thumbs up to this video if you liked it, and leave a comment. In addition, if you would like to try a free copy of my Adobe creative profiles that I created just for landscape photography, then click in the link in the description to this video, and it will take you to my website where you can download a free sample pack of Adobe creative profiles just for landscapes. Thanks so much, and I'll see you in the next video.